Okay, here we go. Till now we have seen many processes, and also we have seen how to actually fabricate an IC and how many process steps we go through. The simplest process which I shown last few days is 16 mask process, and you can imagine now any additional feature I add, I will have another mask on it, another metal, another mask, and if it is a tungsten stuff, I may have another mask for it. So there are many masks keep adding, and each mask cost $1 million plus. So it is not that so trivial that add another mask. Okay. So process wise, one has to plan very carefully how many masks will be required, and that is a designer's job as well as process people job. So now somewhere now in 2012 onwards or 10 onwards, both technology and designers should sit together and actually plan what is the system to be designed. Okay. So it is not arbitrary. Earlier in 1970s, a very famous professor, Carver Mead at Caltech, he suggested, and which he successfully did that as well, that a computer scientist can design a chip without knowing absolutely anything of technology. Okay. He himself was a professor of computer science, he was a professor in electrical engineering, he was a professor in applied sciences, material sciences, he was, there is called courtesy appointment, he was in 7 departments. In spite of all of that, and this was his first book on VLSI design appeared. This is the first textbook in VLSI design appeared in 78 from Carver Mead. Of course, there is another author with him was Miss Lynn Conway. She was with Xerox company, and surprisingly, the first IC chip interest was shown by Xerox company and not by any Intel or anyone. You know, first such chip usefulness was shown by Xerox people, and Lynn Conway was the chief of design group in Xerox. Okay. So this is some history. So I just want to tell you that now the technology knowledge is as much needed for designers as is designs knowledge is as much needed by technology people, and together should also know a little bit of physics, a little bit of chemistry, material science, optics, and whatever you think about. Okay, little bit at least you should, at least terminology should be known, what is it talking about. Okay. Okay, so we start now with a new topic, and we have seen in that last so many days that certain films we grow, but there are very few things we can grow. Mostly silicon dioxide can be grown out of silicon, but the rest of the time I'll have to keep depositing films. Okay, of different kinds. So the process which is very dominant in all IC manufacture is depositions. And anything you deposit, we see, we have seen other day that there will be selective etching of something. So you need to etch something. So the next part of this is etching, because how good etching you do will be deciding the characteristics. So etching and deposition to some extent are not necessarily exactly complementary, but to some extent they are complementary. Whatever you deposit, somewhere you etch. Okay. So somewhere you etch means somewhere you deposit. So there is some theory, at least some processes you can say, like RF depositions, what we do normally, RF based, they can be used by just changing the RF source polarities as an etcher. Okay. So that is exactly what you do. So that is why I am trying to say you that many things are similar, identical, but not everything. So let us see each of them separately. Today we start with a little basic of thin film depositions, and at least two of the most common methods of depositing films we'll discuss, and unfortunately all that I will discuss today is rarely used these days in manufacture. Okay. But they are the precursors. Our labs have many such evaporators, so I think we'll discuss that. In an integrated circuit fab, many films of different materials are deposited. Typically films can be metals, metal silicides, they can be dielectrics like nitride, oxide, many others. And so these are all films you need to deposit. So a typical system which allows you to deposit and the film which you are going to get, this is essentially called film deposition, because normally the thickness of these deposition films or thickness of deposit layers are very thin comparatively. It is not 300 microns or 10 microns, it may be few 1000 angstroms or 2000 angstroms, or at best half a micron, 5000 maximum. So in that case they were called films. Okay. Films are actually, we are not doing this course here, but otherwise I may tell you there is another technology which is used in SOCs, SICs, now SIPs, is called thin film techniques and thick film techniques. Okay. So the idea there was thick film techniques will be thicker films and thin film techniques will be thinner films. There are requirements when thin films are thicker than thicker films and thick films are thinner than thinner films. So all games are only namesake, but let's look at the requirements of deposition. Any system which I use should have, it should be able to give me desired composition of film which I want to deposit. It should not dissociate. If I am putting silicon dioxide, it should retain silicon dioxide property after depositions. And it should not allow any contaminants with it, because if it allows contaminant, then whole process will get tarnished and we will not be able to proceed further. So low in contaminants, and any composition should be retained after the deposition process is over. Okay. Most cases, if they are used in silicon IC manufacturers as interconnects or many other areas, or even insulating films, they should actually retain their electrical properties in the best fashion. If you are a conductor, it should give largest conductivity possible, which should not modify its conductivity. If you have a dielectric film, it should retain its dielectric constant, okay, and also porosity. So one of the major requirement of any system is that it should remain good electrical property of the film which are desired by you for the next processings. The mechanical properties should also be very good. There is some very important property, maybe I'll show you later. When you deposit a film, you have a molecules or atoms coming, mostly atoms. In some system molecules also can come. So if these atoms are impinging on substrate, they should stick, otherwise they'll move away. Okay. So there should be something called adhesion or sticking coefficient available. Unless there is a sticking, these atoms, please remember what is the problem. These, whatever this energy, whatever these ions, electrons, I mean sorry, the films, atoms are coming, they are energetic, they are not zero energies. So when they sit, they lose their kinetic energy and they may actually move. So worries are that that energy should not be so high that they actually displace something and move themselves. So it should be retained as the film they want, we want to. Okay, that's very typical. So adhesion is very important. Of course, we'll see in CVD later. There are two kinds of adhesion properties or adhesion energies we use. One is called surface energy. The other is called volume energy. So when to have what higher or lower will decide whether the film will grow or it will etch. Okay. So a mechanical property is very crucial for any deposition system. It should retain and give whatever property I am looking for. Then I want any film I am depositing on a wafer of whatever size I have. I may have 4-inch, 8-inch, 12-inch, 16-inch wafers. It should be uniformly deposited all around the same thickness, same compositions. Okay. That's minimum what I am expecting. Because if everywhere changes, then I don't know for each chip or each area what is the film thickness. Okay. So that's it should wafer to wafer, on wafer, wafer to wafer and run to run. Their thickness should be as what you are looking for. The next important process step, next important requirement is, as we have seen yesterday vias, for example, if there is a step something like this, so the metal film or whatever film you are depositing, it also should follow that step. Okay, coverage has to be full. What it can do is, if this is my step, I may actually get this. In some regions, there may not be any sticking. Okay. So there has to be a property of your system which will allow coverage of all steps. Okay. Conformality is the most required property in any IC manufacturer. Okay. So this is, as I said, step coverage is the most important part which system should allow, and the material should go inside that wherever vias are or voids are created. If the films are metal and they are used as interconnects, as I just now said, they should provide you very low resistance per micron or per length. Okay. Because essentially, if you are running an interconnect, what do you mean by interconnect? Some signal is going from one point to the other, okay? And the length of interconnect will be large enough compared, that's why I call interconnects. This R is larger, what will it create problem? the delay RC time constant will increase, and it may happen that this RC time constant equivalent frequency may be same as what your system clock or your signal frequency is going on. So you may actually have 180 degree out of phase signal going. Okay. So it's a very typical problems, one going to 0, 0 becoming 1 because of delay signal. Okay. Because you most circuits are these days, there are two kinds of circuit, as Professor Desai talked about, one is Gale. Okay. Think of it, there is something, some circuit has to be locally synchronous, globally asynchronous. Some circuits are globally asynchronous, locally synchronous. Synchronous means time with the clock which you generate or you have in your system. Okay. So all signal need not be, there may be some asynchronous signals going, and many process, many systems do use asynchronous transfers. Okay. It doesn't mean, please also for the circuit people I may say, asynchronous does not mean there is no clock. Okay. It's not a static logic. Asynchronous essentially means it is not running at the system clock. Is that word clear? So asynchronous has nothing to do with non-clocks. Okay. It may still be clock system. For example, one of the features which I keep asking the M.Tech student when they come for interview, take a latch, two inverters back to back, there is absolutely no clock. Why it should be called a synchronous system? Okay. It's a timed system when there is no clock. Okay. So how it acts as a clock? I mean, there is no clock going given to it, but a latch is essentially a time signal based system. Similar thinking has to be done in designs. So some are asynchronous, some are synchronous, some are non-looking synchronous, okay, latches for example. So these all issues of course independent of all that, but this RC time constant, since it affects that very much, of course one method which circuit people use is buffer it, keep pumping every after certain length, you actually have a buffer stage and you pump it again. So the delay is taken care through the buffer out. However, that means you need an additional power every certain length because you are signal pumping every now and then. This additional power is not good because you are reducing the power of the system and you are saying, oh, I'll put buffers. It will take area, large area, because it will be a larger buffer. So all these issues are related to interconnects. So to some extent, my giving a correct interconnect is a crucial part for me because it will at the end affect the performance of the, performance means speed of a circuit. So somewhere don't think that interconnects are very trivial. Interconnects technology is very crucial because that decides the performance at the end of the day. Okay. All this I just want to show you how around we think. Okay. Same way this interconnect have a problem which is called electromigration. Typically electromigration can be thought like this, you have some substrate or something and you have a metal layer. Now this metal layer these days are getting thinner and thinner, okay, because of scaling. Also we are finding it now that this film which we are, this earlier our, since we are not scaling voltages, the currents in, because the area is now reducing, current density which wire is now taking or thin interconnect is taking is increasing. Is that clear? The number of electrons per square centimeters are now more, okay, compared to earlier one, because you are thicker of this, so per unit area will be smaller. Now it is larger current densities. If the current density is very high, which can be typically say greater than equal to 10 to power 5 amps per centimeter square per cm square, then this is called critical current density, called JC. If J is greater than JC, then there are a huge number of electron densities available and ions there. After all, metals are ions and electrons. But since there are a huge number of electrons per unit area and you are applying a voltage, that is why the current flows. So it creates an electric field and large number of electrons are accelerated with this electric field and they create an effect which is called wind effect. They create an effect. Ions are very immobile thing because they are very heavy, they stick to where they are. But electrons are very light. They are acquiring energy because they have large number of carriers per cc, per centimeter square, and you are applying currents, voltages. They actually pick up enough energy from the fields. Okay. These create something called wind effect, and they have enough force, kinetic energy required, to actually dislodge ions, okay, as actually dislodge ions. So if there is a small crack in your metal film growth, wherever it is, somewhere here, so this whole metal will actually climb from here, and there will be a gap between the left side to the right side. The metal will climb up, okay, from that cracks, okay. So there will be a gap between interconnect, and when this will happen, it may not happen in first day, the crack may be small initially. So initially circuit may work, after some day you find it did not work, everything was connected, everything was fine, chip was working, and tomorrow, of course, we used to say in class, it's electronic mood, the mood is migration, okay. The metal actually climbs, okay. So there is a reliability issue, this is called reliability aspect, and one has to worry that any time, and that is why someone was asking other day, copper has better migration compared to aluminium. Aluminium has the lowest migration density, so at even real 10 to the power 4 or little higher, it may migrate, okay. So this electromigration is a major issue, and probably even now in all SOC systems or all systems which are hardware, so co-wire designs people are doing, one of the major worries is migration. Volume is not only that, but area you are reducing all the time, and fields you are not reducing, increasing, because voltage you are not scaling. If you scale everything exactly, nothing should happen, but it's not happening. So that is the, there are issues which are called reliability issues, which is hurting both process people. So one method, when we actually lay the interconnect, there is a case there itself, we should think, if this is going to carry, how much currents in this area. We know by, because I am designing chip, so I should actually add additional features there, thick, I must announce I need thicker or at least wider, okay. So all this interconnect design is becoming very, very crucial now as we are scaling down. In 90s, when I had many students, and I myself used to design, now I don't. In those days, this was all irrelevant, 5 micron, 3 micron, 1 micron, all fine, everything is fine, okay. Things are changing so fast now that every day one has to worry about failures, and failure means money. So all the problem is economics. So please remember, this electromigration is not trivial. Now people are looking from layout to reliability. People say you look at the layout and declare how much yield it can give, okay. So there is a CAD tools have been developed for layout generation to reliability issues. So these are all problems of what you all think, new problems for 2014. The next problem which a metal system or any film system I am expecting is non-corrosive. It should not oxidize, particularly copper film, for example. It should not become copper oxide. And please remember, copper oxide is not just one kind of copper. Copper has two valencies and can give C2O or CuO, and both are as bad as far as corrosion is concerned. Some have lesser etchability, others have stronger etchability. So depending on how much oxygen it picks up, I may have worse phases, okay. So this is very crucial in actual processing. Then of course, this you can write whenever someone has desired this. This line you can, without thinking, write economical, bahut costly nahi chahiye. That's why we don't use gold so often, because gold is actually not as costly as platinum. So we use platinum and keep saying gold is costly. So this is something another, if you go to a jeweler, you never buy platinum. Of course nowadays I am told I don't have enough money to buy, so I don't know. But otherwise, platinum jewelry is also available, which is costlier than gold jewelry. But gold has that aura, okay. Platinum doesn't have. In the lab, if I have a platinum target, I may even keep it like this, no one will pick up. But if I have a gold target, I am sure next day it will not be there if I just keep it, okay. So the worries are terrific in economics, okay. And all similarly, the 10th also, you can always say, it should be compatible to all other processes, because suddenly you say, 1200 degree per current, no, we have 800 fixed, 1000 fixed, no one more than that. Whatever compatible other processes are, this cannot be different from. Okay, so these are, I mean, these are all, not that it is not given in, but I just numbered you to show that what is so much important for a deposition system and depositing system materials. There are two major methods of deposition of films. One is called physical vapor depositions, the other is called chemical vapor depositions. Okay. First, we will only do today, possibly, I am not sure, but possibly PVDs, which is physical vapor depositions. And as I keep saying, there are two kinds of physical vapor depositions. One is called evaporation, the other is called sputtering. Other is called sputtering. This, I am not sure whether we will finish today because it needs some plasma, so maybe we will do something on plasmas today. The second possible mechanism is chemical vapor. So you actually have a source which can be of any form but should convert to gaseous form, and those, whatever material you want to deposit, the gas form of that should move on the substrate, and by some temperature pressure adjustment should stick to the surface and deposit. Okay. Is that clear? The gas will come, it will some way connect to the surface of the substrate which you have kept. At a given temperature and pressure, there is some mathematics we can create and we say when it will stick. Okay. So a layer of that species can deposit on. It can be silicon, it can be silicon dioxide, it can be silicon nitride, or for that matter any metal. So CVD is very popular, but as I say, there are number of CVDs possible. One is called atmospheric pressure CVD, low pressure CVD, plasma enhanced CVD, and hot wire CVD. If you are working with Professor Ram Gopal Rao, he will take you someday to ground floor lab inside and see that, you know, this is hot wire CVD, everything can be done there. Okay. Let's do evaporation first. And once we do evaporation, we will say, okay, there are some problems with evaporations, and as I say, no one is now wants to work with that. Okay. So we went for sputtering, which is another PVD. Sputtering is still used, 100% used, but it has also has its own problems. Okay. Like for example, this conformal depositions are very difficult in sputtering systems. So it can deposit, it is not that it cannot. You need some special gadgets to do that, whereas CVD normally will always go through conformal or contours, it will get take steps. Okay. So in most cases where, and all ICs we have seen so far, every step there is a different thicknesses everywhere, so any film goes, it has to actually follow everywhere. Okay. And that is our worry actually. If it does not follow, then we have a worry. If it follows also, we have a worry, because then we have to do CMP, we want to planarize. So there are all issues. Okay. So we will look into the first one, evaporation, PVD. Actually both PVD and sputtering have some basic similar, but only method of, this is also deposition by a kind of evaporation, sputtering, but it is slightly different in nature, so we will discuss it later. Typical PVD process has four possible steps, or looks like that. You may have a source material which you want to deposit. So it may be in the solid phase or it may be in the gaseous phase. Okay. We say condensed phase. Okay. Except gas, both liquid and solid are called condensed matter. Please remember, this is a, if you are not knowing this, do not walk into the last classes of our corridor, chemical, chemistry, physics, they will shout at you. So, okay, the condensed phase, the first thing we do is by some method, process which is called evaporation, this condensed phase changes to gaseous phase. Okay. Now, this gaseous phase is then transported to some place where we want, again in the gaseous phase. That means something is coming, flux of gas is coming and it is moving up and it is also reaching here. So that is the gas phase position where it has reached. And at that point, which is my substrate where I want to deposit something, it converts into solid phase. Okay. So this is typically the way process of evaporation or process of any deposition takes place. Okay. repeat starts with any of the solid or liquid source, then it evaporates, converts to gas phase, transports, still in gas phase, condenses and deposits. Okay. These are only my figures to show how things happen. I could have said in one line, but just now it sticks to you that this is how it happens. Okay. Why there is something I have to do here, why I have to do something here, okay. Why something I have to be done here, because if I just say something, you will not appreciate that each places I have to do something to actually do better there. That's why the four stage. That's the only thing I can add from the book, which book doesn't know. Okay, I don't know plumber anytime visited lab, but hopefully. Okay, I'll show you the list of them, then you will not ask me. Just a minute. Wait for whatever things we can deposit. Okay. Your answer is electrons, I can deposit anything. Anything. Okay, so what are a typical requirement of a evaporation system is, it should have a vacuum. Okay, the system should need metal films or any films. They can only go properly if you have a vacuum system. All around there is a vacuum. Okay. Typical vacuum which is needed in evaporation is better than 10 to power minus 6 torr. Okay, 760 torr is 1 atmospheric pressure. Now you go and look at the Google, there is a bar, there is a Pascal, there are dynes, force per unit, this centimeter square, this per second, all kinds of units are there for pressures, okay. Just look at it, how many is, at least 5 or 6 units are there for pressures. Generally, because the Torricelli was the person who actually worked on vacuum, he was trying to show vacuum has huge potential of pressure building, and because of that, that credit was given to him, and the pressure was then called torr, and less than 1 atmospheres are normally expressed in torr, otherwise it will be in the larger this, which will be either force per unit area, or it may be pascals, or it may be bars. 1335 pascals is 1 torr, okay, so smaller units. Okay, I'll give you some numbers. In my 32 years, I have gone through all kinds of units. Okay. So this 10 to power minus 6 torr is a very low pressure, means better vacuum. This word also should go, better vacuum means low pressure. Okay. I have a better vacuum, so it doesn't mean 10 to power 1 atmospheric pressure, it's not a vacuum, it's a atmospheric pressure. So I need a better vacuum, possibly better than 10 to power minus 6 means minus 7, 10 to power minus 8, 10 to power minus 9, and even if it is better than minus 9, it will be good for something, but it may be bad for something. So I don't want to go below 9. In some specific molecular beam epitaxy, I may go for minus 12, which I may not be able to retain, but I want minus 12. But how to generate this vacuum, that itself is a problem, because I need vacuum to be actually constantly placed there, wherever my wafers are there, where is my source of deposition system is, everything is inside a chamber which is I actually evacuates, and it should maintain the pressure. Why I am constantly telling maintain? As things will evaporate, what will happen? Pressure will actually increase, okay. So vacuum will go spoil, it will spoil. So I should know, okay, if I am depositing this much time, so my vacuum has to be little higher, better earlier, so that even with this, it should not go below minus 6, okay. That is the word better, okay. As I say, ultra high vacuums are better than minus 9. There are different kinds of pumps, maybe some I list them later, which one can do to actually evacuate. Heating system, evaporation is normally a process in which the film which you want to deposit it, I just now showed the four stages, so I want to convert from solid or liquid to the gaseous state. So I must provide thermal energy, kinetic energy, so that it evaporates. Now the question arises, why vacuum? One, of course, I will show you some other reason. The most important reason why I am going for vacuum is if I dip, I can heat aluminium wire, for example, or any wire by some other ceramic heaters, okay, 1400, 1800, 3000, it will start evaporating, nothing wrong with it, but all oxygen around, okay, so it will oxidize in no time. So all that I want the film to be as, that's what the requirement I listed. So I want that there is no oxygen content in, better the vacuum, the gas inside will be very, very small and mostly nitrogen, okay, it is more inert, okay. So we would like to see that better vacuums are used because it will not oxidize the film during heating, no oxygen around. Of course it does have the quartz chamber which you put releases oxygen. So it's not all that trivial, but still. So one method is, of course, you heat it, actual heat it, okay, it's called thermal heating. The other is you give an energy of heat for heating by electron beams, okay, and we'll show you the two of them. Typical energy which we use is 1 to 10 keV, okay, kilo electron volt, kilowatt is the power, but if the energy is keV. So to keep a vacuum, it should be covered some way, okay, so that is called bell jar. And also whatever film I am growing, depositing, I should be aware that how much film thickness I am depositing. Well, if too thick a film I don't want and too thin also I don't want, so I must monitor it. The monitoring system should also receive the films but should not interfere with the substrate any time. So thickness monitor is also a part of any such system. Then there is another problem which one sees, how do you stop the evaporation? One method is you shut off the power, don't evaporate. But there is a still retentive heat, as we call latent heat, it doesn't go immediately, so it will still evaporate even if you switch off the power. Some you are already heated more than desired, so by the time it goes below that temperature where it evaporates, it will still evaporate. That means the thickness will not be what you are looking for, okay. Now this is an issue which therefore needs some kind of stopping physically. So we put a shutter. So as soon as my evaporation over, I bring shutter above the source, so nothing can go to my substrate, it will hit to the shutter system. So then therefore we need a mechanical shutter to control the flux going to the substrates. Typical vacuum system is shown here, which is not the best drawing or neither the best correct actual evaporating system. You have earlier we used to have quartz bell jar, nowadays we have stainless steel bell jars, which is slightly better compared, because they, why stainless steel is better? Very 316 in specific has a very low content of oxygen. 304 has, okay. Those who are metallurgists should tell me why. See, 304 steels are, stainless steels are not as good as 316. These are the numbers, okay. So, kabhi lab mein jao to dhundo ye SS kaun sa hai, 316 hai, 304 hai. Normal steel bhi use hota hai. So, stainless steel is not the only steel. Unless chromium is added, there is no stainless on that, okay. Okay. The typical bell jar, this is where it is, earlier we used to have quartz, now we will have stainless steel jars, okay. If it was, that's why we left quartz jar, because quartz releases some oxygen, okay. So we wanted to get rid of that. Then there is some holder over which the impurity, I mean the film which you want to deposit, pieces or gaseous, whichever form you want to keep, you can keep there. Then this red part I added just to make a shutter system, which has a out. Please remember the trick of the trade is all its operating knobs are outside the vacuum, okay. But if I move anything, the vacuum should not change. So something has to be done, some kind of Wilson seal as we call, which allows us the movement without actually when I move it presses hard. So it actually doesn't allow vacuum to go back, okay. So we need to have all kinds of Wilson seals around so that no vacuum is released, otherwise air will just get in. I move something, it will, air will go. So all controls, every control, electrode, everything is controlled from outside, which are mostly mechanical or electromechanical. But they should be separated from the jar, they should get in but should not. But any time I do motion, it should not change my vacuums. How to create a vacuum? I have a vacuum system which is connected to this orifice. There are two kinds of, if you only want minus 6 or minus 7 torque, when I say minus 6 means 10 to power, minus 6 or minus 7 torque, then you can have only two simple pumps. The first is called rotary pump, in market it is called mechanical pump, and the second pump is diffusion pump. Okay. So a diffusion pump can only operate if the pressure below it is 10 to power minus 2, okay, I mean where it is sucking. Diffusion pump cannot operate in atmospheres, so it needs vacuum at least 10 to power minus 2 to improve on that. 10 to power minus 2 torque I can create by rotary pumps. So I have a rotary pump followed by a diffusion pump. So first rotary pulls the vacuum to minus 2 and then I start diffusion pump. And once diffusion start, pump starts, it will start evacuating gases from above and will exhaust out. Okay. This system, maybe some other time I can show you, there are 7-8 kinds of pumps, each has own problems, turbo, non-turbo, but anyway right now this course will look into this. Okay. If you are in a lab, at least that is what we have been told when we were students, or we were even engineering people in TIFR, that if you spoil a system, you have to repair. Okay. So if vacuum pump does not work during your evaporation, it is your job to open it, see what has gone wrong, read it, understand it, repair it and fix it back, because other person is waiting to use that. So that is the method we learned. So we almost know A to Z of system which we work, simply because one in so many years something will fail when I am working, then I will be stuck. Okay. 4 months I spent only on designing an electron beam system. Okay. I have no idea how it is. The old one is not available in market. So I designed my own. Okay, so please I go this. If you vacuum it, then there is a heating something here which I can create, heater, which will convert this into gaseous phase. I open a shutter. So this gas molecules or gas atoms, depends on what you are evaporating, will actually move upwards. There is a target system where substrates are held. This typically, this target system is some kind of spherical or cylindrical, rather spherical part of the sphere. And the wafers are held everywhere. And the very important thing which we do there is, if in a large half sphere there may be say 24 or 32 small wafers we can fix. So I have a mechanical motor on every wafer on the top. So wafer actually rotates. Okay. And this whole spherical system also rotates. What is it called? Planetary system. So in all evaporation system we have a planetary system in which whole sphere of the holder is moving and each wafer is also rotating. Why we did this? Uniformity and step coverage. Any angle this time when it will come, I will see evaporation that side. So step coverage as well as uniformity is possible by planetary system. What is planetary system? Half spherical dome inside which there are wafer holders, as many wafers you can hold, and this whole system keeps moving, and whole each wafer which has a small motor on that, DC motors, now they are degassing, so usko bhi protect karna, they keep rotating. Okay. There is a rate at which you should rotate. Okay. So there are all kinds of electrical engineering goals in designing this planetary system. Now question arises, few things before, of course we will come back to it again. Why vacuum? One of the thing I said it, that oxygen I do not want, or any other species which can create some kind of impurity I do not want to have take. But that is not the only reason I want vacuum there. Vacuum has more relevant requirement is, we will see this formula little later. Depending on atomic radius of any species which you are evaporating, the mean free path of this gas molecules or these gas atoms is inversely proportional to pressure. Okay, is that okay? So what happens if I want, let us say this distance is 1 feet or 30 centimeters. If I want the incoming atoms to reach substrate without collision, why if they collide what will happen? They will split everywhere else, so they will not go to the substrate area. So I want them to go upwards only, okay, without collisions. The collisions means if the collisions will not happen, if the distance, I mean if the mean free path is larger than the distance you are travelling, okay. The pressure and mean free paths are inversely proportional. So larger the vacuum, larger is the mean free path, so more likely you will get flux which is going up, okay. So two reasons vacuum is needed. One is modeling of evaporation is a, therefore since as I say I need to do all processes in the system, I must provide you the growth rate, okay, or time for which this film thickness is achievable. So I must create model, okay. For everything which I do reality in my lab, I should able to create equivalent model, only then computer also can do same process. So here is a model for evaporation. We have some definition first. We define a partial pressure P star of a gas which is in equilibrium with its condensed state, okay. You have a condensed state, solid or liquid, and what is gaseous total pressure which is exerting on it is called partial pressure. At a given temperature, this is fixed, okay. So for a species, so that is P star. What is the total pressure which is outside? Is that in a chamber there is a net pressure, but at the vacuum to the, I mean at the material to this, whatever number of gases, they will also exert a pressure, that is called partial pressures. There is a Gary Lussac law in chemistry, lead it, okay. What is the difference? Whenever there is a condensed state and you are evaporating, or some reason the vapors are there, vapors are always there even at room temperature, but their pressures are much lower because the amount of gas which is available in room temperature is very small. But when you heat, enough molecules are there, they will exert pressure on the condensed state, that is called partial pressure. Whereas the chamber pressure, or if it is in room, that is called the atmospheric pressure or room temperature, which is the P, capital P, okay. This is called P star. And we know the larger the temperature, more molecule atoms or molecules will come, so pressure will be building as I heat some. So it is found, I will prove this, and that is what the proof I want to give. P star is only a function of temperature for a species. This I will prove by maths, okay, or physics, whatever it is. Maths is always needed for physics. P is defined as ambient hydrostatic pressure, which is normally around, other than the condensed state, wherever the net pressure is called the P. According to Hertz principle, or Hertz law as it is called, the evaporation rate is proportional to difference of partial pressure and the vacuum pressure outside. Okay. Is that clear? The difference of that. Okay. In general, in vacuum, P is taken close to 0. It is not 0, but close to 0. Compared to P star, it will always be very small. So one can say it is proportional to partial pressure. Hertz says that evaporation rate is proportional to partial pressure difference, he said, but I say okay, P is normally close to 0, but we may not assume it, we substitute that value, and if mathematically it will get subtracted accordingly, 6 decimal bar accuracy. These days computer has 128 bits of accuracy, no? So you can use it. Then there are two more terms we define, Vg and Vc. Vg is the volume of evaporant in a gas phase, and Vc is the volume of evaporant in condensed phase. Condensed phase means either liquid or solid, mostly solid. So their volume will be very small because they are solid or liquid, confined to area. The gas moves away. So the volume of gas phase is always larger than condensed state. If we define delta HE as the enthalpy change going from one state to other, the correct spelling is written here, Clausius-Clapeyron. These are two scientists, and in those days scientists only used to become engineers. So first they will do physics and then they will build a system. So according to this equation using thermodynamics, dP star by dT, that is rate change of, or not rate, temperature dependent change of partial pressure, is proportional to enthalpy divided by T times Vg minus Vc, differential volume. Typically, as I say, Vg is much larger than Vc. Why I say you? Because Vc will condensate either solid or liquid, very small volume, gas large enough, so Vgs are much higher. You can keep Vc also, if I give a value you subtract and it will be smaller. Typically constant of is proportional to unity, so it is delta H into T into Vg. This is typically dP star by dT. Delta H is enthalpy, energy of formation of atoms, okay, or retaining that atomic structure or atomic bonding, that is given for a given material, for at a given temperature. So for a given temperature delta H is known. So I know dP star by this is this, but I also know this gas which is now I created, though it is not accurate to say it is it's an ideal gas, but we still believe it follows ideal gas laws. We say PV is equal to RT, ideal gas law. So P star VG is RT, okay, where R is universal gas constant. Is that okay? PV is equal to RT, 7th standard mein padha hai, abhi bhi wahi hai, change nahi hua. So dP star, usi equation ko re-modify kiya, to dP star by P star is delta H RT square, PV is equal to RT ko likh diya, and then reorganize the term. So you get a term which is dP star by P star, delta H by RT square dT. I take integral of that, ln P star is minus delta H by RT plus some constant, which I take ln C1, constant can be in any form, so I take ln C1. Then I write P star is C1 e to the power minus delta H by RT. Abhi bola tha na, P star is only a function of temperature. Precious Clapeyron has proved that partial pressure is proportional, e to the power minus hai na. So e to the power minus infinity is how much? 0. E to the power 0 is, if T is infinite, this is 0, so 1. So larger the partial pressure, larger the temperature, partial pressure is larger. Iska kya meaning hai? Jyada heat karoge, jyada vacuum, jyada pressure badhega, jyada flux bahar aayega. As straight, evaporation ka model aage. Aap chahte the na ki evaporate kaisa hota hai, yaisa hota hai. P star badhate, all that we are doing is increasing the vapor pressure. Now I am not interested in pressure, I am interested in kitna film aayega. I want rate and I want to know how much it will grow there. Okay, so I first find evaporation rate. Now we can see from here there are two fluxes involved there, okay. One of course is the one from the source, the flux which is going up. But from the substrate which is not sticking, there is a pressure P outside, P star like this, P from the top, it will return some flux, okay. Return some flux, okay. So this evaporant's vapor pressure down is essentially P dependent, external pressure or vacuum dependent, whereas this condensed pressure is dependent on the vapor pressure at the condensate, okay, just above that, how much is that. Now using this, if A is the cross sectional area through which this flux come, then there is a statement made by Hertz which says 1 upon A dNe by dT, where Ne is the number of atoms involved, or atoms or molecules sometimes, rate change of this, this is the rate of number actually going with the time per unit area. What does that mean? Flux. This is essentially a flux which can be given by 1 upon 2 pi mkt to the power half p star minus p0. This is essentially called Hertz-Knudsen equation. This is called Hertz-Knudsen equation. But this is, as I say, is the rate, represent the evaporation rate. So evaporation rate R is 1 upon A dNe by dT. 1 upon 2 pi mkt to the power half p star minus p, and p is how much? 0. So it's very small and can be used or not. But just now I also said that some flux may return. Okay. So we say whatever is not sticking may come back, not necessarily because of pressure alone. Something which did not stick comes down. Okay. The ratio of what is coming down to what is going is called alpha v, which is related to sticking coefficient. How much sticking coefficient I want? 1. Everything should stick, nothing should come. So alpha v is typically maintained close to 1. This is where oxidation, but this is nothing, this is a vacuum, this is ideal gas law. There was no gas law used there except at the last flux. There we have three different fluxes, except in gas phase we use gas law, the other was solid, there is no solid here. Here there is only vacuum, but there the partial pressure was inside solid and inside silicon oxide, and this is no partial pressure in solids, okay. This is partial pressure in vacuum, okay, on the condensate. Okay, so REV, which is evaporation rate, is 1 upon 2 pi mkt to the power half p star minus phi. If we say alpha v is close to 1, then you can neglect alpha v, otherwise I'll have to give a coefficient 0.9, 0.87, whatever number generally people, in most cases we get alpha v close to 1, most cases if your system is well designed and you have a good, how do I improve the sticking coefficient? Anyone? If anything has to stick here, what, how can I improve sticking? Reduce, then it will move about, no? I want stick increase, so substrate be heated, actually it will pick up that. It has an energy to bind, you need energy to bind, so you provide substrate heating, is that clear? So as you increase 100 degree temperature, most of the material will stick, is that clear to you? So there is a alpha is adjustable value. Okay, let's talk of two things. Have you written down this? This is very, as I say, I am writing all this formula for what purpose? I keep saying my process simulator has all those formulas built in. Then why I am learning? Because if the new process comes, you should know how to actually model it. Okay. One of you may do, maybe one out of 123 may not do, but at least the availability of one person, I know how it is. For him only this is. There are two things, as I say, in the pressure P. One, of course, is the if you use something called Knudsen cell, where we can restrict the pressure, so it can be made zero. There is nothing from outside pressure coming in, so I can reduce that word number. The other, of course, as I said just now earlier, I want to improve mean free path. So this pressure is very crucial. Smaller the pressure, larger is the vacuum. And larger is the vacuum, lambda is, so the at least how much lambda it should be, whatever is the distance between source and the substrate, at least 3 times that you should have mean free path. Typically I may say the distance may be 30 centimeter and a mean free path of 100 centimeter is necessary for having one directional film growths, film depositions. I repeat, typical distance between substrate is a 1 feet or 30 centimeters. So at least 3 times that should be the mean free path. Sigma is the cross section of atoms per unit area. P is the pressure. T is the temperature at which you are doing this. Rest everything is known. So I can always calculate lambda, mean free path, for a given temperature, for a given pressure, and for a species which cross section is known to 10 to power minus 4 per centimeter square or centimeter square, whatever area atomic volume a square cross section area, you can substitute that number. I will give in case I ask you to evaluate. I never set the paper till last day, so I cannot myself tell you what I will ask. Only last day I decide I will ask this. So in that case offhand I cannot say what I can ask. Lambda is kt upon root 2 pi sigma square p, where sigma is the capture actually cross section of the atoms which we are looking at, pi r square, okay, pi r square, r is the radius. Everyone, I am not sure, I have not read Plummer's book, but must be, I mean, all these are not novel or something. This is not first time. It was done in 18th century to 19th century. So most of things are known to everyone. Like this I picked up from physics book, something I picked from thermodynamics book. Now after I picked up, many others I also picked up from the same source. They never told that I have done it. Everyone is doing same. Some of them are of course my own derivations, but in our times it was not very important to tell world that I have derived it. I derived it. Nowadays before you derive you say I have done it. That's the only difference. So typically REV is alpha V P star upon 2 pi MKT. Then there is, to make alpha V 1, there is an, if you have, this is your place where you are heating the material to be evaporated. I have another small chamber around whose orifice or the is A, same as what you write everywhere A word. And now you can see if anything goes out or comes in, there is a very little chance of return attacking anything. It's called nuts and cell. It's a little costly, so most evaporators do not have that. But I just tell you that this is possible. No, see, if you are buying labeled or any small advert system, you want to buy in few lakhs, so all these features are not given. Okay, as straight as that. See, nuts and cells are used if you are doing some better vacuum system, like MB, if you see a molecular beam epitaxy system, it has a nuts and cell. Okay. And because they are putting 3 crores and above, okay, then they will put you this. Design of a chamber around the source. Okay. It should be degassable, it should not actually release gas. If released, it should be first cleaned up. So there are many features with nuts and cell. It should have an area which is adjustable, which I fixed it right now. So nuts and cell is a nuts and cell. Okay. But our aim is not evaporation rate. Our aim is to growth films, thickness. I want thick how much. So I say the growth film growth rate is decided by evaporation rate divided by into mass by density. That's the growth rate. Okay, film growth rate. Rho is the density. So if I substitute this REVP from here, this can be written as M upon 2 pi kT rho star by rho, P star by rho. If I adjust for a given species, kT, all these constants I know. For a normal rho, I assume that these are the metals where rho is roughly this. This comes out for aluminium at least this 5.83 × 10⁻³ A m by t to the power half p star, where A is this area of a nuts and cell. Or if there are no nuts and cell, whatever is the this area itself is the area. So if I want thickness, what should I do? Just multiply by the time of evaporation. So that much film thickness you have. You know film thick per centimeter per second. This is the deposition rate going on. Whatever time, whatever thickness you want, you decide time and what time it should do, then shutter should come. Okay. So there is a timer outside which can automatically do this. You set the time for the thickness you want. It is also connected, that way I have not shown, but there is a film near the substrate on the both sides. There is a monitoring, this thickness monitors. Okay. They also receive same films and they are mostly transducers. Okay, they are capacitive transducers. So we actually monitor how much is the thickness of the film. We are, it's a tactile sensor actually. Okay. So pressure change hua, I can figure out how much is the thickness. Okay. You know tactile senses. Jitta tactile. Where do you use keyboard which has a tactile sensor? Pressure sensors. Okay. So tactile sensors, jitte film vajan hoga, utta pressure bada dega. Wo monitor ho jayega. So I know how much, I first calibrated this thickness first. So shutter just comes, stops. As soon as shutter comes, power shuts off. So it is not that in our system we don't have anything like this. So you have your hand on the shutter, your watch like this. This is what we do. Okay. The reason is I am not interested in numbers of them. Okay. So what is the actual evaporation process is? It starts from melting the evaporant substance as you increase the temperature, the vapor pressure increases. This is summary of what I said, and evaporation of substance starts. Is that clear? Source of evaporation could be either a point source or maybe extended point source. If you have an extended small area source, little more mass needed, because now there are multiple points evaporation. Most cases we take it point source and solve mass. We wish to find now deposition slightly. What was our assumption? All molecules are traveling straight. Okay. But there are wafers all around. So some flux will go at an angle. Though they may not interact, but they certainly will not only travel vertical. They may at an angle also they will travel. So if you have a film a substrate like this, the film thickness here and film thickness here will not be same. Is that clear? If this is your target, some flux is coming, some like this. So there is larger correct thickness here, but not necessarily same as this. So some angle which it is subtending has an effect on the thickness. Spherical reduces that, but still it's a away position. But the reason there is a spherical, because this unless the nuts and cells is designed that it actually matches with that R, it has the same problem, okay, equivalent problem. Right now I am assuming only horizontal substrate and hitting it. So is that clear to you why I am interested? Because I want on a wafer, a number of wafer, same thickness. Yeah, it can be. If you put the source up down, it will come down. There is no problem. But you just look at it. If it is your evaporant is liquid, what will happen to it? Gravity jo hai wo niche hai na, to wo solution niche aa jayega. Isliye upar se rakha to upar hi jayega. Yeah, all possibilities are true. Only think of all possibilities. If you are solid source, it will also fall. But you can put a clip. If you put a clip, what material I should use? Is that clear? So there are issues. In this, gravity se wo andar rakh sakte. It doesn't bother us. Okay. Simplicity of system. But theory wise, it doesn't matter if it comes down or it comes up. Okay. If sigma is the solid angle over which source is emitting, solid angle, all directions. Is that clear? So there is a solid angle associated. It's called omega. And rho is the density of evaporant substance. And these are the distances I nominated. These are h vertical. This is the distance at L where I want thickness, and this is the R. Okay. And let's say it subtend an angle to vertical as theta. Then, since it is this all around, so I will assume here and here it will be same. Here and here it will be same. Where theta is, it will be same. Is that point clear? Spherical. So everywhere same R. So all those position ending at R will have same thickness. Is that clear what I want? I want to find thickness. So roughly what I am doing is, I assume a vertical parallel plate, I measure it and put an angle to that. That's what I am. I did not show you exactly in formula, but the real is I'll actually do as if vertically in one direction it comes, and projection of that along that axis, cos theta of that. This figure is 100% must be given in book, so I am not saying this is, because this is needed. How much thickness round? Okay. How I thought it is projection, uska example hai. Yahan liya, uska project kar diya. Assuming it is vertical and at an angle, what is the projection? Okay. So that is the method maths people do. So I thought I will show whether it is same theta. Is this theta and this theta are the same? Yes, they are. Only one nahi na, ye pura aisa sab jagah hai na, cone, so solid. If vacuum is better than -6 torr, mean free path is as good as 100. Since typical distance between source and target is typically 30, please don't think it's a hamare isme to 50 cm hai, then usko 150 chahiye wo, then accordingly you push yours. So H is typically 30 centimeters. We can assume flux transport reaching target with scattering at an angle at low pressure. Return flux target is very, very small. Nothing. P is not affected. Then is that solid angle is how much now? 2 pi. Surface and idhar dekho sir. 2 pi. 360 degree. So the solid angle is 2 pi. Is that okay? The flux density reaching a vertical case is R evaporation by area to whatever 2 pi R square. The growth rate is R upon 2 pi R square m by rho. From geometric considerations, what is geometry? Triangle H square plus L square is equal to R square and cos theta is H by R. You want to just a minute, H by R is cos theta. Theta is angle from the vertical, so cos, the base is on the vertical. Base by hypotenuse is cos, so H by R. And geometry itself, since it is a right angle triangle, H square plus L square is R square. Thoda maths karte hain iske upar. What is that I am looking into? Film growth rate at an angle theta. R evaporation f upon 2 pi rho to hai. Aur ek term aana chahiye jo angle pe de. Please check it because when I solve it, I don't check it. Okay. Maybe sometimes I make mischiefs. Do read the book and verify I am right and tell me also I am right. Why I say so? At least I will know you are read. You read from the book and tell me I am right. And if not, that's good, then I will modify. Actually, I am writing it so much because I am actually doing whatever lecture I prepare, I just think I am writing there so that I don't have to redo it. I should not do this method. I should only say give points and you should think. But the way I am preparing myself, I am just writing without seeing anything. So, okay, for your sake, I have given you three lectures today. And the earlier 3 or 4, whatever they are, they will be available on Moodle in next maybe 3-4 days. Okay. But I keep telling you, and my undergraduate students will verify that. So growth rate any point L from the vertical point is R of m cos theta, and this cos theta, as I said, is h by r. R is h square l square under root. So cos theta is h by r. Cos theta by r square chahiye mujhe. H by R cube, cos theta by R square is this, sorry, R cube, no, R square, theek hai. Then the film growth rate is R evaporation m upon 2 pi rho, H upon H square plus L square to the power 3 by 2, this R cube aa raha hai, isliye 3 by 2, R square to idhar se aa raha hai, ek aur R hai na, cos theta mein H by R hai, okay, aur cos theta jo hai, by R square is H by R cube. The R cube ke karan 3 by 2 term aa raha hai. I now know how much is the film away from, if H is the distance and L is the point where I am measuring thickness, I know roughly how much is, will be smaller or higher, denominator is higher, larger than the numerator. Obviously, the maximum flux will go straight, some will go on this. That is why that planetaries are required and rotating systems are required. So if everywhere gets, so every position finally will be seen equivalently on an average and therefore uniform films thick growths. Last ko material puch rahe the, wo dikhate hai, phir we'll start e-beam next time. Okay. Is that formula clear? Any point away the flux reaches is smaller. Okay. So thinner films. And uniformity, how do I get? If I have planetary motion, it rotates, wafer rotates, so everything is roughly seen uniform. From where that was designed is this formula. This was used to actually design the planetary system. How much away? Okay, so what rate you should move so that this actually goes uniform. So this is not just for the sake of it, it was used for design. There are typically there are two kinds of sources we use for this. One is resistance heated, e-beam heated. E-beam will see later, but today only will show you resistance. Usually the heating source is made of wire filaments, not wires, wire filaments of either tungsten, tantalum, molybdenum, many others. What are these metals called? Transition metals. Very unlikely for they will evaporate, I mean their temperature of melt is 3000 plus. Okay. Now if I want to, if I pass current through this tungsten or tantalum or molybdenum filaments, will heat because they are I square R, it will heat. Okay. The maximum temperature which most of them can give for a typical currents of the order of 200 amps to 300 amps is 1800 degrees centigrade. Most metals which we use can evaporate at 1800 degrees. Typical deposition rate using a resistive source is around 1 to 25 angstroms per second. This is I square R. There is R there, current I square R, simple wattage. The materials which can be, if you do joules, it will be much better, but it's not joule. There is no second material on that. Okay. This is not joule. Joule actually is done because it's a cold heating, as we call it. Okay, some other time. Okay, the materials which can be evaporated by this technique are aluminium, tin, chromium, antimony, germanium, indium, gold, silver, magnesium, calcium. Any species. It can also deposit so called compounds, cadmium sulfide, lead sulfide, cadmium silicide, where, and even calcium fluoride. Where do these first three are used? Anyone? Solar cells. Solar cells. Then we can deposit NaCl, KCl, magnesium fluoride, calcium fluoride. Calcium fluoride is very important material for self-assembly nanostructures. Calcium fluoride is one of the biggest candidate for self-assembly nanostructures. I repeat, most things can be evaporated which has a melting temperature around 1800 can be evaporated. Anything higher than 1800 or 2000, it cannot be evaporated. Just the last slide for the day. The typical filaments shapes are something like this. There is a hairpin kind of this. Then you have a wire which you want to evaporate. Uske upar aisa loop bana ke dal do. You understood? एक हेयर पिन है उसमें वायर फोल्ड करके डाल दो. एल्यूमिनियम वायर है उसको बेंड करके उस पर जितना ज़्यादा चाहिए उतने चार पीसेस डाल दो. ओके. व्हेन इट स्टार्ट्स मेल्टिंग इट विल एक्चुअली कवर अप ऑल दिस वायर बिकॉज इट विल फर्स्ट लिक्विफाई द सरफेस टेंशन विल इंक्रीज सो वो ऐसा चारों तरफ फ्लो हो जाएगा एंड देन इट विल स्टार्ट एवेपोरेटिंग. समटाइम्स यू हैव अ वायर बिगर वायर एंड लार्जर फ्लक्स यू वॉन्ट यू हैव अ सम काइंड ऑफ ए कॉइल and you put wires inside, spherical coil. उसके अंदर में wires डाल दो जो भी operate करना है आपको. उसके wires होना चाहिए. समझो आपके पास wire नहीं है, PC है. तो इसके एक basket बना सकते हैं wires की. Former मिलता है, इसको heat करके form करते हैं. उसके अंदर वो piece डाल दो. Since this is smaller than this, it just fits inside. If you have a, you want something species powder. Then you can use boron nitride crucible. उसके चारों तरफ भी एक coil wind कर सकते हो और इसके अंदर powder रख सकते हो. Okay. So it's not necessary that what shape. You give me shape, I will actually create the kind of filament it can generate. The power currents are passing through this. You need a current transformers which can give you typically 200 to 300 amps of currents. Thank for the day.